Good morning, everyone. Welcome to today's webinar, Processing and Analyzing Hyperspectral Imaging. The outline of today's webinar is the value of hyperspectral analysis, hyperspectral sensor types, data processing, analysis in NV, integration with ArcGIS, and summary. So before we go into the deep, let's understand what are the remote sensing data sets are available. You may work either all of these data sets or some of these data. Let's start with the multispectral. Multispectral data is a three band or more than three band data, like example, Landsat or Sentinel. Hyperspectral imaging, which contains more than 30 number of bands, and each pixel contains certain information. Then we have thermal imaging. Either it's multidimensional rasters or a single band imaging. It works for your surface temperature analysis and other relevant studies. Then we have synthetic aperture radar, the SAR data which penetrates the cloud and capture day and night throughout the season. Then we have elevation data sets which help us to do the topographic and surface analysis. And we have very high resolution data sets like aerial and drone. So now today we will focus on hyperspectral analysis, and let's see how we can read, process, and analyze these hyperspectral images. 60% people are new. I just wanted to give you the highlight of what hyperspectral remote sensing and how this data can perform. So to give you the overview of what hyperspectral remote sensing, hyperspectral imagery and remote sensing is nothing but to acquire digital imagery of Earth in many narrow contiguous spectral bands. And these hyperspectral sensors or imaging spectrometer measures Earth material and produce complete spectral signatures with no single wavelength of emissions. It's a small, I can say it's a zoom part of a multispectral remote sensor. So let us understand little bit background of how these hyperspectral imaging. The capability has been around for many years, but we struggle to process this large size of data sets. And now we have overcome these challenges and processing these data sets very quickly with available infrastructure. Hyperspectral imagery contains large number of bands, at least 30 bands as compared to multispectral. And the multispectral imagery like Landsat image or Sentinel can give you a class like iron bearing minerals, or agriculture, forest, water, etc., where hyperspectral can give you the exact type of minerals because each band and each pixel contains certain information. The hyperspectral imagery just like a zoom button, where hyperspectral being a very zooming view and gives a lot of information. When you talk about multispectral, which being a blurred skin, so you can see in an image in a top, which the wavelength in a micrometer, the curve is very rough. But in town, when you see the same zoom part of the particular area and see this how the material looks like, you can see very smooth upon. Like, how exactly these data sets are captured? What are these sensors are available when you talk? There is a lot of sensors and hyperspectral sensors are available. And these are satellite-based, aircraft-based and UAV-based. So you may see how these all sensors are carrying number of spectral bands which is more than 50s and spectral resolutions in nanometer. Let me take you the newly launched sensor called Prisma. The spectral range of Prisma is 415 nanometers to 2500 nanometer and 238 spectral bands. You will see how these data can perform in NV and ArcGIS Pro. People who are working on drone and UAV data sets, they are using maximum HiMap or headwall sensor. And other remote sensing professionals who are working with the airborne and aircraft data, they are using average data sets. And you know, these set of all number of wavelengths, and when you got these type of nanometer range, which contain exactly lot of noise. To understand what type of noise, let's have to understand about data quality and issue. The quality of hyperspectral data is hampering by these noise, and when you start reading the data and analyzing these data sets, you will get to know these noise like sensor calibrations, sensor drift, irradiation variation, which is relevant to solar energy, aerosols, and water vapor, then atmospheric attenuation in scattering and absorption, and atmospheric path radiance in multiple scattering of the signals. To correct these data sets, we require advanced remote sensing software that is called NV. Hope this NV, advanced remote sensing software, support you to perform hyperspectral analysis. NV was developed originally to working with hyperspectral imagery because it is so fast at process large data sets and process these hyperspectral data and remove band and other atmospheric and data stripping errors. We can use hyperspectral image analysis tools to radiometric calibration, atmospheric correction, pixel care and pixel statistics and other spectral tools in NV. NV also provide automated workflow for hyperspectral analysis with NV modeler, and these modelers we can take into ArcGIS Pro as well. So when you have get these lot of spectral tools are available, when you have to plan to perform these, so we require the ground information. So NV provides you more than 5000 plus standard spectral library, and these library are built by USGS, ASTER, JPL, and these library will give you a lot of information, and we have lot of spectral indices which can help you to perform geology, mineral, water, agriculture, urban, forest, fire fuels, and many more applications. Let us see how this process of hyperspectral imaging can perform in NV and end-to-end workflow. As we know, the data contains the noise. We start with radiometric correction. So, the radiometric correction, we can correct the radiance. The atmospheric correction tool help us to correct the apparent surface of reflectance. And you can see when the different variation of these data, we will start about the data reduction. And the data reduction part, you can predict, either you can do the spatial and spectral subset of the feature and perform analysis. Then we have end member. The end member generation, which can help you out to create a signature or build a spectral library. And these library, which can help you out to create another spectral library signature file, which can further use for hyperspectral analysis for material identification and target detection. And once these spectral libraries has developed, you can also apply on different specific analysis like vegetation indices, mapping fire fuels, detect minerals, mapping soils, and water quality mapping, and many more. Let us understand bit more and see available tools for entire workflow. With radiometric correction, we can correct radiance and convert to the reflectance image. Atmospheric correction tools help us to correct apparent surface reflectance value. And these always depend on the different atmospheric parameters. When you talk about the atmospheric correction, you have to understand there will be atmospheric gases are available when the images come. And the atmospheric features present in the radiance data and overall shape of the spectrum will be dominated by the shape of the solar irradiance. So you can clearly see in my image that how the radiance curve and how it converts to the reflectance. And when you talk about these correction, why is required? Like when you have performing the chain detection analysis or when you are performing any mineral or material mapping, these libraries play a very important role. So we have to get proper reflectance image. This is raw DN. When you talk about the inputs, I can say like surface reflectance, solar irradiance, atmospheric scattering and absorption, then variation in illumination due to topography and lot of instrument errors. So the first step we have to perform, we have to calibrate this unitless and raw digital number from the sensor to compare physical units in radiance and removing instrumental effects like removal of solar irradiance curve. So ND provide two set of atmospheric corrections like flash and quark. Apart from that, there is a couple of workflows available. So once you have finalized it, your initial radiance image, then after atmospheric correction, we have to apply, right? When we have to plan to apply, we require the spectral library. And NV include these spectral library visually and analytically compare image spectra with the reflectance spectra of identifying minerals of interest. But also, like I can say, it's possible to build own spectral library, and it give you, you can create your own ground collector spectra also. You can create and import as ASCII files here. And these files you can further use for any type of feature identification or material identification, classification, segmentation and all. So then we talk about the complete end-to-end workflow in terms of data reduction to end results. NV introduces the spectral hourglass. So this is a complete end-to-end workflow. As we discussed, radiometric correction is the first process and followed by the minimum noise fraction transformation, which reduces the dimensionality of data set and combining information of all bands, and pixel purity index of spatial reduction to set the threshold limit of the selected pixels, where ND visualizer step we designed for end member selection. And we can see in a practically that how these end members can perform and can we can select. And then finally we have spectral pure pixel in scene end member identification. Once we perform and come up with this complete spectral hourglass model, finally we have to go to the mapping methods. Whether it depends on your interest, depend on the required and the output which you require, we can select the different mapping methods, whether it's binary encoding, spectral angle mapper based classification, spectral feature fitting, or the OSP, which we can say orthogonal subspace projections. So here are the certain classification tools which NV provides. NV provides various tools, pixel based classification, like I can say supervised, which is traditionally work supervised classification techniques, unsupervised classification technique like ISO data classification and k-means. Then we have our object based feature extraction, which like example based feature extraction workflow, rule based feature extraction workflow. Then we have decision tree classification workflow. We have post classification for compute classes, confusion matrix and all. Then we have end member selection. In addition, there are spectral tools available to perform the hyperspectral analysis, like the data processing tools and the spectral library management tools, where you can create your own spectral library, and spectral math tools, ND visualizer tool for selecting end members. Then the spectral identifying tools and various methods of mapping many materials, like I can say where you can talk about which I can say like continuous removal, or I can say match filtering. Then we have vegetation analysis tools, like you can perform NDVI and all. Then pixel purity index tools. Apart from that, there are total 74 plus spectral indices tools are inbuilt. And out of these all tools, around 59 is relevant to vegetation indices. And there are in 7 different categories like broadband, narrowband, canopy, canopy water, light use efficiency, leaf pigment and all. And with that, I am requesting Ramaraj to demonstrate to hyperspectral analysis. So Rudy, can you please transfer the rights to Ramaraj? Ramaraj, you are in mute. Unmute yourself, please.
Is my screen visible?
Yes, go ahead.
Yeah. Hi, good morning, everyone. Kiran already gave elaborate view on the hyperspectral image. In this session, we will be seeing about the processing and analyzing of the hyperspectral image by using the NV software. First of all, what is NV software? NV image analysis software uses scientifically proven analytics to deliver expert level results. Businesses and organizations choose NV because it integrates with existing workflow support, today's most popular sensors and can be easily customized to meet unique project requirements. For this session, I have used the EON Hyperion imagery downloaded from the UGS website. We can easily download the data directly from the NV also. For that, open world data, download web data. Here you can able to see the list of websites available to download the data set from the various websites. Here I downloaded the data from UGS Earth Explorer. Okay. Here I already loaded the data that I'm showing it here. So this is the Hyperion data, which contains 242 bands. This is the FCC Vast Color Composite Combinations. This Hyperion data set contains 242, out of which 198 bands are non-zero, remainings are zero bands. So the list of bands available in this Hyperion sensor can be viewed through the data manager. So in data manager, it will list all the available inputs which is included in this Hyperion sensor. Here you can see the warning symbol with respect to the particular bands, which represents the bad bands. So this bad band should be removed for further processing. So the removal of these bad bands is called the bad band removal. The bad band removal can be done using two ways. One is from resize data from toolbox, and another one is from the that we are directly saving from the file savers option. That I am doing it from the savers option. Here you can see the two things called the spatial subset and the spectral subset. The spectral subset, the list of bands will be displayed over here in spectral subset. Then apply BPL. Apply BPL in the sense apply bad bands list. When we are applying bad bands list, it will exclude all the bad bands. It will include only the bands with non-zero values. Okay, then save the data and perform this operation. Okay. After removing the bad bands, atmospheric correction is mandatory. So the signal recorded by the sensors are a combination of signal from Earth surface, atmospheric constraints, and sensor errors. So those sensor errors has to be removed for further processing. So for the atmospheric correction, we can see from the radiometric correction, there are multiple atmospheric modules available. Based on the compatibility of your data and the need of your study, we can select the atmospheric module. So here I am going to do the flash atmospheric correction. The data which is recorded in the raw data sensors, it is the digital number. So those digital numbers should be converted to radiance values for further processing for the atmospheric correction. For conversion of the radiance value, I am going to perform the radiometric calibration. So input, choose the input and okay, apply flash settings. So when we are applying the flash settings, it will automatically take the default settings of the flash atmospheric module, then save the output file and run this radiometric calibration. So after the performance of this radiometric calibration, the result will be automatically loaded in the layer manager. Here you can able to see the difference between the before and after the radiometric calibration. Before, what it has happened, this image does contains all the bad bands. So after removing the radiometric calibration, it is excluded the bad bands. Now the images look like this. All the digital numbers now converted to a radiance values. Now we can directly go and perform the flash atmospheric correction. So now the flash atmospheric correction window will appear. These are all the various inputs are required to perform the flash atmospheric correction. Now choose the input radiance file. That should be radiometrically calibrated image. Use single factor for all bands, always one. Then give the output reflectance file, output directory also. Root name for flash files, I'm giving surface reflectance. So whatever you want, you give it as your wish. Surface reflectance I'm giving. Then scene center location. Scene center location, it will be loaded automatically, or otherwise you have to enter manually by seeing the metadata file. Here you can able to see the various hyperspectral sensors that can be atmospherically corrected by using the flash atmospheric module, that is Averys, Hyades, HiMap, CSA, Hyperion, ISA, and unknown HSA. Then multispectral, there are various multispectral images are there. Here I am going to perform this operation in Hyperion, so I am choosing Hyperion. Sensor altitude can be taken from the Hyperion sensor specifications, giving 705, ground elevation 0.1, and the pixel size should be 30 meter. Then flight date and flight time, it will be loaded automatically. Then atmospheric model, it's selected based on the seasonal latitude surface temperature. So here you can see the subarctic winter, some US standards, subarctic summer, mid-latitude summer, tropical. So based on my area, I'm choosing tropical. The aerosol model can be selected based on the pollution of the area, whether it is rural or urban. It can be selected according to that. So I'm giving rural. Then spectral policing, in order to smoothen your spectra, spectral policing can be given. For water retrieval, the image bands must cover 770 to 870 nanometer, 870 to 1120 nanometer, 1050 to 1210 nanometer. So it cannot be performed in the multispectral sensor. So it can be performed in hyperspectral sensor. So I'm giving yes. I'm giving aerosol retrieval, 2 band KT. So number of bands, which means the band interval between the one band to another band can be given here. So I'm giving 9, and the wavelength recalibration I'm not giving. Then initial visibility should be 40. After entering all the necessary inputs, we can run this flash atmospheric correction. Okay. Now, after performing this flash atmospheric correction, you will get the loaded image over in the layer manager. So this is the flash atmospheric corrected image. Now you can see that all the radiance values are converted to a reflectance values. Later we will see about the spectral library creation of each components from the imagery after identifying the each and every purest pixels. Next, in order to find the spectrally purest pixel, we have to use the two process called the, as Kiran mentioned, we have to use two process called minimum noise fraction, and another one is the pixel purity index. For minimum noise fraction, I'm using MNF from the toolbox. MNF. It will take little bit time. It is loading. So forward MNF estimates noise statistics. Then choose the surface reflectance. And okay. Give the output noise statistics file name, output MNF statistic file name, and save your data also. Here, the number of output bands will be produced depend upon the number of output MNF bands you are giving here. So now I'm giving 167 bands over here. Then I'm running this MNF transform parameters operation. So after this, you will get the noise removed image like this. Then we have to find out the spectrally purest pixels over this image. So for that, so I'm going to show the spectrally purest index from pixel purity index, new output band, choosing MNF as an input. Okay, number of iterations 10,000, give it as such and run the model. Then finally you will get the results like PPA. So these are all the spectrally purest pixels that is extracted from this imagery. Then we can do the n-dimensional visualizer to highlight all the spectrally purest pixels over the surface reflectance images. For that, I'm going to perform the n-dimensional visualizer. For that, we can go to that spectral n-dimensional visualizer, n-dimensional visualizer from auto cluster. Give the for performing this n-dimensional visualizer, we need two inputs like MNF and PPI. MNF, then PPI. So it will ask you for the maximum number of input pixels. So then, after entering all the inputs, then run this performance, then you will get the results like, so this is the, it will display two windows like n-dimensional visualizer and n-dimensional controls, just to start the animation. So these are all the spectrally purest pixels that we retrieved from the n-dimensional visualizer operation. So I'm just showing the axis, sure axis. So now it's showing the spectrally purest pixels with respect to the selected bands. So when we are giving 4 pixels, it will give 4 axes. According to that, it will display the spectrally purest pixels also. In order to display all the spectrally purest pixels over our surface reflectance, we need to create the ROI. For that, I'm just stopping this animation and creating ROI. and rattling on it, just export the class. After exporting the class, it will be loaded automatically on the data manager. So from the data manager, we can load it those pixels to the, those ROI to the spectral surface reflectance images. Then we can start performing the creation of the training data set and spectral library in order to give the accurate results. So I'm just closing it. Now we can go for the spectra development from the atmospheric corrected data. Now for the creation of the spectra development for each component from the imagery, for that I'm just going to the spectra profile. Just move the cursor towards the component where you want to collect the data. Spectra. Just moving to the water body. So here this values in y-axis you can see 0 to 10,000 values it will be represent. Those values are called as the apparent reflectance. So those apparent reflectance, we want to convert that into 0 to 1 means we can divide that by 10,000 by using the bandmath operation. We can collect the multiple spectra in a single window also, further just expand it, change the name and the color of this spectra, water. This spectra make it vary, it depend upon the water body, whether it is deep or shallow, and the pollution conditions of the lake water body also. We can compare it along with the normalized spectra, that is standard spectra from the URGS. I'm just changing the color also. So give new windows with plots. Then move the cursor towards the some other point. Now change the color. Just track it and put it in a single window. So likewise, collect all the spectra from the various components. Now I have already collected the spectra. I'm just going to display the things. For that, display spectral library viewer. Input ASCII spectral library. Okay. So these are the various spectra I have retrieved from this Hibernian sensor. So in order to smoothen the data, we have the curve smoothening option. So we can use the curve smoothening option in order to smoothen the data. So this spectral library can be taken forward to perform the spectral angle mapper, that I will do it now. For the classification process, we have taken the spectral library from the various components. So those training spectra can be used to train the unknown pixels. Those process is called the spectral angle mapper. Spectral angle mapper is a physically based spectral classification that uses an n-dimensional angle to match the pixel to reference spectra. So for doing the spectral angle mapper classification that supervised classification, spectral angle mapper classification, choosing the data, okay, and input the spectral library, select all, apply, and choose your output file and perform the spectral angle mapper classification. After this performance of this spectral angle mapper classification, you will get the results of that. These are the classified image of spectral angle mapper. Then you can compare this classification with the maximum likelihood classification that we are normally doing for multispectral image. So I'm just comparing these two images. So those two classifications are providing almost the same results. Now next I'm moving on to the mineral mapping. In multispectral imagery, due to less spectral information, it is very difficult to extract mineral information. But here in this hyperspectral imagery, mineral mapping can be done easily due to enormous spectral information which will help in geologists to identify mineral information and its distribution. The image used here, Aviris covers a cupric hills area of southern Nevada. Here I have already identified the various minerals like silica, kaolinite, putingtonite, bornite-type and calcite, and I already highlighted that by using the ROI, region of interest. Now I'm going to compare the particular spectra, that is kaolinite spectra, with the UGS derived spectra. For that, I'm just clicking over the cupric reflectance data. This data is already atmospherically corrected by using the flash atmospheric model. Okay. for extracting the data, spectra of the colonnade. So I'm just moving the cursor towards the colonnade portion, expanding it, and changing the name also. This is the image derived spectra, which I'm going to compare with the UGS derived library spectra. Keep it as such, then display. For viewing the UGS library, spectral library, display spectral library viewer. From that, IGCP Cal09 KL500. So here, this spectra is called as a continuum reviewed spectra. So this spectra also need, or image derived spectra also needed to be converted to a continuum removed spectra. For that, why? You can see three values like data value, continuum removed, and binary encoding. I'm just giving continuum. It will be converted automatically to a continuum removed spectra. So I'm just tracking it, changing the color before tracking. Okay. I'm just tracking it, putting it over here. I'm just zooming into the wavelength of 2000 to 2500 nanometer. The double absorption features near 2200 nanometer offers a good reference point for comparing image spectra to library spectra. Similarly, we can collect all the spectra from various minerals, which we can compare it with the UGS spectral library. The components which are not listed in the UGS spectral library, that we can take the spectroradiometer value, the reflectance value, that we can compare with the image spectra value for the validation purpose. So now after collecting all the spectra, I'm going to perform the spectral angle mapper. So after performing the spectral angle mapper, you will get the results and the distribution of the minerals over this area. So silica, calonite, pertinctonite, wernerstita, and calcite. Next, I'm moving on to the vegetation analysis. For this demo, I have used the EON Hibernian hyperspectral imagery to identify areas of dying conifers resulting from insect damage. You will learn how to create vegetation indices that exploit specific wavelength ranges to highlight areas of stressed vegetation. Kiran already gave a detailed view on the different kind of vegetation indices that I'm going to perform as a practical session over here. So for in this, I'm going to find out the areas of vegetation within high stress condition. For that, I'm going to do two analysis. One is the moisture stress index and another one is the forest health vegetation analysis. For doing the moisture stress index, from toolbox, band algebra, double click on the spectral indices, choose the atmospherically corrected image. Here you can see the list of biophysical indices available. According to your need of your study, you can select the indices. It will automatically take the various band combination and perform this analysis. Here I'm performing the moisture stress index. So moisture stress index, choose the output raster file and save it. It will be loaded automatically in the layer manager. So here you can see the spectral indices, that is moisture stress index derived image. Here we need to find out the vegetation area, those are all having damaged within high stress condition. For that, I'm going to use the raster density slice operation. Choose the moisture stress index file. This raster color slice windows will appear. Delete all the colors and now include one image. Keep the slice maximum value as it is. Slice minimum value should be 1. The pixel value above 1R will be highlighted in red and indicate the areas with high stress vegetation condition. Okay. Sorry, it is not loaded at all. So I'm going to perform this operation once again. Sorry. Moisture stress condition. Let it load. If the value is 1, then okay. So here you can see the areas with high stress vegetation with high stress condition. we can compare this value, this results with the forest health vegetation analysis. For that, I'm going to spectral. From spectral vegetation, forest health vegetation analysis, choose the input and modified red edge normalized vegetation index, coordinate reflectance index 2, and then structure incentive Pickman index. Then choose the output file and run this. The resulting image after this performance, the resulting image does not automatically display on the layer manager. We have to choose it and load that in the layer manager. Forest health vegetation does not provide any qualitative measure of vegetation stress. Instead, it will shows the relative amounts of forest vegetation health from 1 to 9. That is unhealthy from healthy. So that just I'm unchecking all the values from 3 to 9. So these pixels represents area with stressed vegetation. So we can compare these two images like raster color slice. So almost they are both are providing the same results. So field studies are further needed to validate whether the areas are correspond with insect damage or other damage. However, the method that we done in this session shows that remote sensing and hyperspectral imagery are effective tools for indicating unhealthy and dying vegetation in forest. Likewise, we can use hyperspectral image for various application as an alternative solution for conventional methods. So thank you. Now I'm hand over the session to Dr. Kiran, doing the same process in the RGS flow. Rudy, could you please transfer the call to Kiran?
Yeah, thank you, Ramraj. So as you have seen, how we can process the data has processed in NV. Okay, so but there is a few things I would like to highlight here. You have did hyperspectral analysis, hypergene and all. There is a new data which recently launched like Prisma. So now we can see how Prisma data can read, process and analyze in NV. So the data can process access. So you can see the Prisma data we have directly ingesting here. So once the data can access here, we can see the total number of bands which are available, around 238 bands which are listed. We can see the meta information, spectral information, and we can easy to do georeferencing here. Once the data has corrected, georeferenced, you can see the resulting results. We can load the CIR and we can see the spectra profile, how the spectra really looks like. So the recent data which launched, that can also ingest directly. So any data we can ingest virtually in NV. So now whatever we can see, we can see the NV and RGS integration. So the L3Harris Geospatial and D3 work together and build a complete end-to-end solution, and they provide the completely seamlessly access and analyze imagery. NV is recognized as the advanced raster analysis solution for RGS users and offer a complete solution which can help you out to take either tools or resulting results we can directly take in MAP or Pro. In terms of desktop, NV analytics can be integrated as a geoprocessing tools. And in terms of enterprise, we can publish these geoprocessing tool as a services. And for RGS online, web user interface can be developed using JavaScript API for RGS to run NV analytics. With NV 5.5 and 5.6, Harris released new set of powerful tools to run NV analytics in RGS. NV analytics toolbox, now we can directly see in RGS Pro and ArcMap work environment. The integration of NV in task-based analytics into the RGS allows running in advanced image processing analysis and to perform where we can access NV directly from the NV user interface to RGS user interface. You can see how these set of tools are here. So the integration part, when we talk about the NV pipe, plays a very important role. NVPI, which offers you to ability to integrate the NV analytics for RGA desktop user. And this integration allows you to generate RGS Python toolbox and containing to the geoprocessing toolbox in NV. So in this example, the same image what you have seen, the Nevada area where how the mineral classification, same I'm going to perform here. And I'm taking this results to directly do showcase same thing in RGS Pro. Let's have a quick look at how this. So here you can see the same results. So we require initially for spectral libraries, right? These spectral libraries, which collected and the libraries has built. As you have seen that how Ramraj has showcased these things. So I'm just showcasing that resulting part here. So now I just enable the spectral analysis, the same what you are seeing now. Now, what I'm doing, I'm just open my MV modeler, and this how I'm trying to create the task, and I'm trying to take this entire workflow to RGS Pro. So here you can see in terms of sound classification, resample spectrum, then we can do the spectral library, query the spectral library, the entire end-to-end workflow which we have connected here. This model now I'm going to take into the RGS. So now we can publish this as a task. And this task file, either I want to issue ArcMap or ArcPro. I'm going to publish into the ArcPro. And we can see now the task is going to publish. As is already previously created, the system is asking, do you want to write? Yes, I'm doing this. And now my toolbox is got created. Once the toolbox is created, we will go to my RGS Pro. And here you can see the geo-referenced every image. So now we can add the toolbox. And this toolbox, what we are doing, we have adding the tool which we have got created. The same task we will add as a Python tool. And now you can see this toolbox, spectral angle mapper toolbox. And with that, I just trying to run the analysis. I'm just give my reflectance image and simple heat it here. And once I can run this tool, the system will take a couple of seconds to process the end-to-end data. So now it's about to finish. Yes, we are results are performed. And you can see the spectral angle mapper classification results. We can enable this and we can see the same results what we have seen in our NV, same results generated here. We can see the different classification types that how calcite, vanish, calonite, and silica has identified. So summarizing this, the hyperspectral data processing and analysis can play a very important role when you are working on the different application, like in terms of mineral identification, vegetation stress, forest stress, and other applications like I can say Geological Survey of India. There is a users like I can say the space applications agencies where the people are working with the minerals and agriculture and forest fuels and some other research organizations. So the hyperspectral data processing where they can use the different type of Hyperion, Epris, then Prisma, all data sets. Then to perform, how to perform this, we will see that is a very important thing to bad band removal and data stripping. Then we see how the spectra hourglass and entire hyperspectral analysis workflow processed and it can perform in NV. Then in the analysis in minerals, vegetation, forest mapping and integrate with ArcGIS, and same analysis we can perform in ArcGIS Pro as well. So we also request you to join our upcoming webinar which we are planning to conduct tomorrow. Create accurate image classification product to aid disaster response effort. So tomorrow 7:30 PM. So do register and attend. And also request to join our GeoNet community and connect with our colleagues and share your experience. And also you can collaborate with us, share your work, and also you can refer the other works and you can do the chat and all. Then with that, I also like take a thanks to everyone